Hi there, and welcome to the Literary Lyricist, where we look at the art and the craft of putting words to music. I'm Dan McGarry. This is the first episode. You no doubt have questions like, what the hell is this show? Why do we need another explainer series? And why am I watching this? Well, let's take those in turn. So what is this show? This is a show about lyrics, song lyrics mostly, though we're not above briefly looking into Broadway librettos or libretti or whatever. But not just any song, though. Adam Neely describes music theory as it's taught today as the harmonic style of 18th century European musicians. And I don't think he's wrong. There are reasons to keep doing this, though, to keep looking at this. Even as we recognize and embrace other traditions and accept that in so many ways our history is deeply racist, it is, in fact, where we come from, and like it or not, it's what we recognize. Now that's changing, and in any creative endeavor, change is generally good. But we all have to come from somewhere, and this series is going to spend a lot of time examining that path. So why do we need yet another video explainer series? Well, because there isn't one, not for lyricists at least. You'll find countless practical, insightful, and deeply, deeply useful video series on music theory, on composition, on song structure, on producing, engineering, mastering, playing your own instrument, and, well, every other aspect of songwriting except, you know, the actual writing part. Putting words onto a page so that someone else can open their yap and make those words beautiful, that's what this is about. So why do it in video format? A few reasons. Songwriting is structural. Visualizing those structures helps us to understand and express the things we know intuitively. And sounds help. I mean, when we're in video, we have sounds. We kind of need to use those sounds if we want to be clear about how music and lyrics coincide. And then color and movement. Some things just don't work on a page, but they do work when somebody's doing, well, a song and dance in front of you. So don't ask why, they just do. The things that work in video are the things that work in a live lecture hall. The things that don't work in video are best left to the manual. Lyricists don't need a manual, and so for our sins, we're left with this. Now, why am I watching? Well, why are you watching this, honestly? I don't know. Okay, seriously. This might be useful to you if you're someone who's taken their songs as far as they can musically, but you still struggle to make them actually mean something. Now, don't take that wrong. Every creator struggles with meaning. And meaning isn't always, you know, capital S serious. Meaning doesn't only wear tweed and smoke a pipe. Even featherweight pop lyrics need to be good. And trust me, there's way more to bubblegum lyrics than meets the eye. And if you're somebody who's coming to music from a literary background, as I've done, then this series might be useful too. The plan right now is to look at pop stars pretty much from the birth of modern English through to the present. Understanding what moved people in the past goes a very, very long way to understanding why things move us the way they do today. So now you know why I'm here, why this show exists, and why you're watching. So let's dive into it. Earlier in the introduction, I said that songwriting is structural. That probably seems like an obvious thing to say. These days, pop songs seem to have reached a kind of Minecraft phase where we use, reuse, and abuse the same bloody building blocks to construct songs that run the gamut of human experience, from why did you leave me to why don't you leave me to I will never leave you to I'm leaving you. And just to round things out, there's I'm glad I left you, and of course, you may have left me, but I'm glad you did. And who could forget that unique gem, I'm gonna leave you just like I left all the others. These songs have a structure that everybody and their dog likes to bark about. It goes like this. Or, for the more sophisticated oral palate, there's this ingenious variation. But talking about song structure at that level is, not to put too fine a point on it, f***ing useless. It's like if this were an engineering course and I told you all you need to know about bridges is this. Got it? Good. Yeah. Unless and until we get a bit of understanding about what an actual pillar consists of and how to make it bear the load of a big bloody arch between you and your audience, then it's not good to anyone, is it? So yes, songs have verses, choruses, and bridges. See what I did there? But I don't care much about verses and choruses and bridges, and neither should you, at least not yet. What we're going to care about, whether you want it or not, is what makes language work when it's put to music. Yes, there are rhythm and rhyme, and we'll get there. But neither one of those is as essential as they may seem at first. You'd be astonished how much structure your song can hold even without them. Let's take a look at some less obviously structured songs and see what holds them together. As any self-respecting engineer will tell you, you gotta know what load tolerance your materials have. Calculating how much weight to put on a particular lyric can be a complex task. Now, right about now, you're telling yourself that you chose music so you wouldn't have to deal with this kind of complexity. You want to go straight from the feels to making it real. But the main difference between calculating structural loads in engineering and writing effective songs is time. In music, you need everything to happen at the right moment, in the right sequence, and in the right measure. Now, engineering generally aspires to permanence. Music aspires to impermanence. Okay, it aspires to be unforgettable and infinitely repeatable in permanence, but do you know what I mean? So here's the question of the day. How many truly memorable songs don't actually rhyme? Now, those of us who did social media before social media will be aware of what a treasure trove MetaFilter is. For those of you who don't, a link to Ask MetaFilter is below. Click and learn, my padawans. My question, well, not strictly mine because there are no new questions under the sun, was give me examples of songs that don't rhyme. And the list is surprisingly long. Before you go and look, in fact, before you think about it much at all, try to imagine what kind of song doesn't rhyme. And I'll bet you dollars to donuts that you're thinking of some slightly obscure B-side whose quirkiness makes up for the lack of craft. Not so. More than a few major hits used very few of the most obvious tropes when crafting memorable moments in song. They are rhymeless and still timeless. Some become timeless through sheer incendiary passion. Now, by now, everybody's heard the story about the night Percy Sledge told his band to give him their slow trademark Muscle Shoals blues riff, and he stood in front of the crowd and poured his soul into When a Man Loves a Woman, a song born from the fire of a woman's scorn. And look at it. It's formless. This is a singer's lyric. If you can't hit those marks, you better not try, because you've got nothing but your voice and six little chords to keep yourself from crashing down. There's no pacing to speak of after those first few sustained notes. A little bit of melodic rise and fall that makes the point driving upward, falls off into explanation, and then modulates as it expands again. interviewed in 2011 for Dutch television, Percy Sledge said it all came together just like that.
When a man loves a woman, how can she leave me when I give her my last dime? I would even sleep out in the rain for her. How could she leave me? And when I find out she done left me, my best friend told me, and I was the last one to know.
And the melody had accompanied him his entire life.
I just sang it all my life when I'd be sad or working in the fields, you know, whatever. And when I want to just hum something, I just hum that same melody.
But the center point that we all know wasn't there in the beginning. On that almost apocryphal night, the line he belted out was this.
Why did you leave me, baby, when you didn't have to go?
It was a local DJ, Quinn Ivy, who encouraged Percy to refine the song into an actual story, who made that one change that made all the difference. He said, tell the story of when a man loves a woman. From there, it all just fell out. Percy Sledge said he'd never written a song before.
I'm just pushing a pencil. I never thought that it would come out like it did.
Well, the result was magical. It's magical because you damn well better be magic if you're going to carry an audience on it. But look, songs like this aren't easy to learn from. The only real lesson a songwriter can take from this is to be simple and sincere and, oh yeah, to be a world-class singer who can belt the blues. I mean, good to know, but you're all those things already, aren't you? No, the real lesson we should be taking is that the lyrics need to have structure enough not just to survive the music that supports them, but to add to its strength. Let's take a look at how one song grew from an organ grinder's tune to become a boppy little half-chanted ditty, and finally, a dance hall monster. I'm talking about Suzanne Vega's 1980s hit, Tom's Diner. All right, let's get this out of the way. Tom's Diner is indeed Tom's restaurant at Broadway and West 112th in Manhattan. And yes, it was the facade of Monk's, where the cast of Seinfeld met and were horrible to each other. Okay, are we back now? Good. The story of the song goes like this. Suzanne Vega used to eat her breakfast at the joint before going to work each day. Vega told one interviewer, it was really written from the point of view of my friend Brian, who is a photographer, and had made a comment to me one day that he felt as a photographer, he saw his whole life through a pane of glass and always felt like he was a witness to a lot of things, but never actually involved in them. She said elsewhere that Tom's was just a joint, not very atmospheric, and in that sense, a rather typical New York spot. Her lyrics are equally stolid and undemonstrative. But just like the diner, all the values on the inside. There's no showmanship here, just a cement-like grid of actions and nouns. All the verbs are present tense, and all the nouns are unadorned. But together, they build a remarkably strong narrative edifice. The blandness, the march of events happening around the narrator lurch ahead with the downbeat awkwardly placed on the three, creating an out-of-kilter feeling as if the words were always a beat behind where they should be. And that's pretty much the story here. The man sees an affectionate welcome, gets short-poured in his coffee by the same person. He reads about a personal tragedy in the newspaper, but he's never heard of the guy who died. The horoscopes carry more weight for him. A random woman appears to make eye contact, but she's just checking her own reflection in the window. This verse is a beautiful piece of economic writing. For those of us who knew New York in the 1980s, this is a tour de force. At the end, the humdrum goes all wobbly. The tempo dies, and the narrator finally lets a little emotion intrude. The result is, to be kind, a finely crafted, forgettable ditty, about as impressive as its setting. It could have been even more forgettable. At the end of Solitude Standing, where this song first appeared, there's an instrumental reprise of the song where, with tinkly keyboards where she'd originally wanted to accompany her. And it's, you know, again, to be kind, cute. The thing has strengths, but it lacks structure. And that structure came from a 1990 bootleg created by a couple of pioneering sampling artists from the UK who called themselves DNA. The duo were sound engineers as well as creators, and it shows. They took that do-do-do-do section that originally provided nothing more than the excuse of an outro and made it into the heartbeat of the entire song. Then they compressed and cleaned the voice, evening the vocal volume, because you don't need vocal emphasis when you're rolling the words across a truly bitchin' beat. The beat is spare, it's clean, bright, and as inevitable as the tide. It's everything Suzanne needed to finish the song, and to her eternal credit, she recognized that the DNA remix deserved its place as a canonical version of the song. It moves with the rhythm of 1980s New York. It's smart, sophisticated, self-aware, and softly despairing. The DNA mix, which in my opinion should be considered the song in its final form, rendered one last service to Ms. Vega. They cut the final lines. Those lines were personal, but they were self-indulgent and too particular. Only on the final line of the DNA version does the tempo finally fall away, and it never comes back. Rather than being called back to reality and trotting like happy bunnies off to work, we never leave the rain, the austere pressure of being alone in a crowded place. In this form, Tom's Diner becomes art. And it also became a multi-million-selling chart topper. Without the DNA remix, it would have been a charming and ultimately forgettable curio. But without the lyrical bones that Suzanne Vega wrote into it, the DNA beat would have been an equally outdated and forgettable bit of fluff. Tom's Diner works because its lyrics are perfectly sculpted. They withstood a complete retooling and ended up supporting one of the landmark songs of the late 1980s, fusing electronica with new folk, urban rhythm, and a wry and thoughtful anomie that preceded the nihilism of 90s tantrum rock. Percy Sledge crafted a musical masterpiece and did no more writing than he had to get to a perfect musical place. Suzanne Vega, on the other hand, crafted a lyrical masterpiece whose genius wasn't entirely evident until somebody else built a proper monument to it. Thanks for watching this episode of The Literary Lyricist. We'll see you again soon.